Here in Canada, it is fairly well understood that the pandemic hasn't hit all communities evenly. That's true globally as well, according to a recent study that dug into why some places and people are faring better than others. Frank Elgar is an associate professor at the Institute for Health and Social Policy at McGill University. He's the lead author of that study, which analyzed social capital, income inequality, and COVID-19 deaths across 84 countries worldwide. And Frank Elgar joins us now from Montreal, Quebec. Frank, it's good to meet you. How are you doing?
I'm great, thanks. Happy to be with you.
Terrific. Your study looked at COVID deaths across 84 countries, as we suggested, and this was earlier in the pandemic. What did you find out?
Well, the big storyline for our analysis was income inequality. Going in, we sort of naively thought that countries that were richer or had a younger population might have fewer deaths. We went in looking at measures of social capital and some economic factors. But pre-COVID income inequality, the gap between rich and poor, turned out to be by far the most powerful predictor for us of COVID-19 deaths. And there are several reasons for that. If you, across the different academic disciplines, if you look at the health and social outcomes of inequality, countries that have wider gaps tend to have larger inequities in health. They have more poverty. There's fewer protections for lower income workers, whom we know were overrepresented on the front line among essential workers. There's more pre-existing illnesses. There's more health vulnerability there as well. So there's several explanations for why, but by far inequality seems to trump just the sheer wealth of a country in trying to predict how they did through the pandemic.
And let me just dive in a little deeper on that, because are you saying that income inequality is actually a more significant reason for why a country would do poorly than if that country as a whole is a poor country?
Exactly. By far, we looked at some 80-some countries, and there are several countries that have lower wealth, but smaller gaps between rich and poor, that did not have the levels of mortality and infection that we saw in countries like Brazil, the United States, Italy early on, the United Kingdom. These countries have higher inequality, and we saw a more rapid rise in their mortality counts during the spring of 2020. And today, if we were to repeat our analysis, looking at do a follow-up on vaccines, we might see some similar trends there as well. But overall, it's a deeper impact, a health impact, where there's a wider gap between rich and poor.
Now, you might expect that a poorer country, where more people were of lower income, that they would do worse than a country where at least you had some rich people who could presumably, who knows what, use their privilege in society to improve matters as a whole. Were you surprised to find out that in fact, is not the case?
Yes and no, because if you look at some of the research done in the social sciences on how inequality has, it affects social connections, social bonds. In our analysis, we did work on using measures of what they call social capital, and these are indicators like interpersonal trust, cooperation, involvement in the community. And more unequal countries tend to have weaker social ties. There's less, I guess, social capital or resources to mobilize a big effort to practice social distancing, to wear masks and so on, to sacrifice make some sacrifices for the common good. So you have reduced levels of trust, reduced levels of cooperation. It's tougher in those circumstances to mobilize everyone. Plus you have more vulnerability lower on the social ladder as well. So those two factors together to us sort of fill in the picture of why we're seeing countries like the United States and Brazil top the charts by far on a per capita basis, the most rapid rise in COVID, and underperforming many poorer countries below them.
The Economist magazine also took a look at national differences and COVID outcomes, and here's what they concluded. Workers in relatively egalitarian countries tend to have more bargaining power and may therefore find it easier to air and redress concerns with employers. This can have its disadvantages, but it may help stop practices that aid the spread of COVID-19. In Sweden, a country with strong workers' rights, frontline or essential workers such as meat packers and police officers have not, on average, faced a higher risk of dying from COVID-19 than others, potentially limiting the overall number of deaths. This is in contrast to results from America, Britain, and Canada, which are more lightly regulated. Now, let me ask you about Sweden, because they took a pretty questionable approach at the beginning to lockdowns and the pandemic. They kind of let her rip, you know, off the top. Did the narrower gap between rich and poor protect Swedes in any way?
Certainly, for a number of reasons. You're right, Sweden is one of the most equal countries when measured in terms of income inequality. They have greater protections for the poor and lower income workers. And although many of us were sort of surprised by their initial response, and it was tough going for them early on because they were underperforming their Nordic neighbors in terms of the spread. They had, I assume, more social capital to rely on. The political opinions were not as divided as here in Canada and in the United States. It was easier to mobilize. They have better health overall and smaller health inequalities as a population. So Sweden, in some ways, it is an outlier in terms of its government response. You could say it's ultimately, it was undermined by that sort of a weak response, a weak involvement by the government early on. But in the long run, it seemed to be the social connections and their economic wealth. They're in a very privileged position. Sweden did okay in the long run. In fact, looking over the first 30 or 40 days of their pandemic, Canada and Sweden place about equal, which is surprising to many, given all the Canada took a big swing in terms of its government involvement and benefits and protections early on.
Indeed. Now, if you live, generally speaking, in a more trusting society, how does that directly have an impact on your health?
Trust is an interesting, It's embedded in the culture. It's a multidimensional construct. In our analysis, when we measured trust in different ways, we found different effects on COVID-19 mortality. If we were looking only at trust in government institutions, trust in the sort of health information you were provided, those countries, those societies have a lot of trust for officials, health officials, and government-run institutions, and are engaged in the community, generally had a slower rate of increase in their mortality. But on the other hand, trust along the social close ties that we have, the in-group bonds that we form, our friends, family, our neighbors, those sorts of connections, and a desire to be in groups, had a negative effect. And this for us was that's why we titled our paper "The Trouble with Trust." It's a double-edged sword. If you're in that sort of social context where you are you believe you trust your neighbors more than your own government, then you can see the social conditions are there for a spread of misinformation or bogus information about COVID-19 that might hinder the public health response or undermine people's attitudes about vaccines.
Any previous examples from history that you think would buttress this point as it relates to trust?
Yeah, well, previous pandemics, if you look at SARS and MERS, the research done in Taiwan, for example, looking at confidence in governments was a huge predictor to vaccination rates. And we're seeing this now play out here in Canada, unfortunately, in a very divided political context where there's a lot of dismissive information and attitudes towards COVID-19 vaccinations. And that's part of what we're calling, in psychology, they call this a behavioral contagion, where there's a rapid spread, a dissemination of misinformation, false information that undermines the common good. And again, it's coming through those strong interpersonal ties, trust at an immediate social level at the expense of distrusting the government.
Let's pull up excerpt right out of your paper, in fact, that speaks to this. You write in your paper, The Trouble with Trust, in-group bonds reinforce risky health behaviors through the phenomenon of behavioral contagion. High trusting and affiliated societies may be more susceptible to misinformation about the severity of COVID-19, bogus treatments, or dismissive attitudes towards physical distancing. I guess we've got, as many examples as where to be an overly trusting society can be a problem as much as it can be a help?
It can be a liability, and I don't want to mischaracterize the situations we're seeing now in the United States with Donald Trump or Bolsonaro in Brazil. There's a very divided, a fractured political context there that I think is fueling a lot of the misinformation that's coming out now about COVID-19. But there's a sort of behavior, this contagion. We're seeing it manifest here in Canada with the rise in the popularity of the PPC, demonstrations, protests in front of hospitals. It might seem ridiculous to so many of us, but those groups have strong in-group ties, and there's a lot of dismissive attitudes about government involvement in all of this. So yes, it's embedded in the culture, it's a complex construct, and when you look at trust closely, you'll see that there's different dimensions of them. Some are going to support a public health response to a pandemic, that, like the one we're in now, and other forms will be a liability to it.
Well, the People's Party, even though they did much better this time than they did 2 years ago, still only got a very small and relatively insignificant percentage of the total votes cast. If you look at the Republican Party in the United States, they're essentially half the electorate down there. So what conclusions do you want to draw about trust in those two different societies?
Yeah, it's a very different, I think Canada and the United States has a very different political opinions, you know, what constitutes the left-wing and right-wing parties here in Canada might sway to the left overall compared to the Republicans and Democrats in the United States. But overall, a lot of this is fueled by, again, coming back to economic inequalities between the rich and the poor. Throughout history and globally, there is a trend where the rise of inequality has been harmful to democratic institutions, just the basic functioning of democracy, and we see greater preferences for a strong leader, an autocratic leader that's going to sort out all of their problems. That's sort of the viewpoints you hear expressed around Donald Trump in the United States, and it manifests in some ways here in the PPC. But we'll see where we are by the next election or two, whether the PPC is still an entity post-COVID. Who's to say?
No, for sure. But if you, I mean, given that you looked at dozens and dozens of different countries, if you take Canada, how do you think we fared as it relates to this income inequality, this trust index, and the political impacts thereof?
Yeah, and so much of the research on income inequality, Canada sort of sits in the middle of the pack. Culturally, we're very similar to the United States, which has wide inequality. But we have better health outcomes and smaller health inequities, due in part by the nature of our healthcare system. Income inequality is high in Canada. However, we have, I guess, stronger government institutions to buffer that. But we're nowhere near the Swedens and Finland's and Denmark's in terms of economic inequality, and due to many factors, our history, our culture, the ethnic makeup of our populations are quite different. So Canada isn't a leader in no measure in terms of closing the gap between rich and poor, both economically and in terms of health. And culturally, you know, looking around the world, we're very similar to the United States on many cultural levels as well.
So we can say, Canada, we're not the best, but we're not the worst either.
Yeah, that's not the greatest slogan for your travel brochure, but it is true. Yeah, we're not a Nordic country, but there's a lot to be thankful for. COVID-19 showed us the role of government in dealing with a public health emergency in many ways. Some people are always going to be dissatisfied with how much they do. We should do more, or we should do much less. But on measure, looking around the world, Canada's response, I think, has been it has been helpful. It has been, it served its function. I know there's a big economic debt we'll all have to pay once this is over. But I think due to our culture here in Canada, wanting to look out for one another, we do see there is a robust role for government to play in dealing with a pandemic like this.
That's Frank Elgar from the Institute for Health and Social Policy at McGill University. Frank, we thank you for joining us on TVO tonight from Montreal, Quebec. À la prochaine.
Thank you very much. Okay.
The Agenda with Steve Paikin is made possible through generous philanthropic contributions from viewers like you. Thank you for supporting TVO's journalism.